Beautiful, the affirmation that God comes to be with us in our worship. As we think about holiness and worshiping a holy God, we are confronted, first of all, with the reality that we are unholy people, sinful people. That means unholy. And that realization needs to be understood in us. And so every Sunday, too, we confess before our God. And not that we are doing pretty good or managing quite well, but rather we are sorry for we are sinners. And this comes through again in the book of Leviticus as it describes too just how we should live. And as we hear that again, it's like the Ten Commandments, but not quite, but similar. And so these words from Leviticus 19 that remind us, convict us of our unholiness. When it says here in Leviticus 19, the Lord said to Moses, speak to the entire assembly, say to them, be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy. And then it starts actually with the command, each of you must respect your mother and father, and you must observe my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. So those are two of the official Ten Commandments. And verse 4, do not turn to idols or make metal gods for yourself. I am the Lord your God. So another of the Ten Commandments. And we drop to verse 11, do not steal, do not lie, do not deceive one another, do not swear falsely by my name and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. Do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Do not hold back the wages of a hired worker overnight. Do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind. So that's very deliberate. If you know someone's deaf and you start cursing them out, that's not good. That's bad. And if you know someone's blind and you put something in front of them so they'll trip, what are you thinking? What are you doing? And so specifically and figuratively, don't do things like that. You're your God. I am the Lord. Do not pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbor fairly. So again, a little different from the Ten Commandments, but reminding, well, we do that. We show partiality all the time. Verse 16, do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Do not hate a fellow Israelite in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so you will not share in their guilt. And do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. And so that's where Jesus gets the summary of the law from. It's not in Exodus or Deuteronomy. It's here in Leviticus. The Ten Commandments plus love your neighbor as yourself. And yeah, do we do that? And then down to verse 30, observe my Sabbath and have reverence for my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Stand up in the presence of the aged. Show respect for the elderly and revere your God. I am the Lord. So all kinds of added details, but very good. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself. For you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Do not use dishonest standards when measuring length, weights, or quantity. Use honest scales and honest weights, an honest ephah and an honest hin. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt. Keep all my decrees and all my laws and follow them. I am the Lord. So Leviticus 19 is striking, even for us again to hear, like we know the Ten Commandments more so, but again too, just to be reminded again too. And the reason it's here and the reason we read it is to recognize our sin and our need for a Savior. Let's pray together. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, holy and pure in all your ways. Lord, we come before you as people you have called into fellowship with you, but we acknowledge that we are still very much, sinful people. And Lord, though we know what we should do, so often we don't do it. And Lord, in how we live and act, how we speak, how we treat others, how we live in relation to you, Lord, we could do so much better. Even as we read through again your word in the book of Leviticus, reminding us too of our sin. And this morning again, we confess that we are sinful people and that we are sorry for how we have offended you and others. Lord, we pray that you would forgive us in your grace and guide us again by your word and spirit as we look to you in Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Right in the middle of Leviticus 19, right in the middle of all of those laws, is the assurance of forgiveness. It says in verse 21 of Leviticus 19, the man, the person, however, who brings a ram to the entrance of the tent of meeting for a guilt offering to the Lord, bringing the guilt offering to the priest is to make atonement for him before the Lord. So this offering, this ram, for the sin he has committed, and his sin will be forgiven. So it's right there in the middle of all of these, how can we be helped? And the offering system is there, but that beautifully points, of course, to Jesus, who is our sacrifice for sin and takes away our sin. And that atoning sacrifice brings hope for us again today. Let's respond in singing together, Refiner's Fire. I want to be holy, that God's saving work would be effective in us. Receiving God's grace inspires in us the love to serve and help those in a world of sin, and so we bring our offerings always at this time with the work of the church as a focus, and also today the idea of justice in this world, that God's justice would enter in. And so as a church, as a denomination, we have too just a clear focus on doing justice in society. And so in different ways, helping the poor, the hungry, the persecuted, the refugees. And so that is the focus of the offering this morning. And the offering buckets are by the back door as you leave. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we thank you that in your work, your gracious work of making us holy, you work in our hearts a desire to see sin stopped in us and in this world. And when we see injustice in this world, when we see the poor who are hindered by all kinds of systems, we're thankful for things that do help, but often too there's just injustice in the structures of society and in how they are treated, Lord, and that we would make a way again to help the poor and the hungry in our country and in this world, Lord. We think too of the refugees who are coming over from Ukraine again, and knowing too, Lord, their need and how they are caught up in a conflict that's not of their making, that, Lord, that we would bring help and hope to them as well, Lord. We thank you that as a denomination we are working with that and reflecting on that and making a difference too in the lives of individuals and speaking to institutions like government, and that you would bless that work. In Jesus' name, amen. We have our children's message this morning. And I wonder if the kids could come forward, maybe Olivia and Abigail. And then do we have some young ones here, Jane, who want to come up for a minute? I have something I got to show you. It's a little bit scary, but it's kind of interesting. And so I have it here wrapped up. Do they want to come or not? No? Okay. Maybe once you see it, you'll want to come. Something happened in my office the other day, and you, of course, come in once in a while and look at the fishies, right? And you name them and everything. Well, it was a little bit sad, but I came into the office the other day, and look. He was on the floor, all dried up. He doesn't smell at all. He's all shriveled up like a potato chip. But you wouldn't want to eat him. This one of the little angel fish that you named, right? And so I don't know exactly what happened. I had filled the tank with water again close to the top. I usually don't fill it all the way. And angel fish aren't really jumpers. But somehow, he jumped out. And that was not good. And I was there right away, so it was probably through the night. And so I found him like this in the morning. And what I have done years ago, I have had fish jump out in my tank at home, and they're a little dry and crispy like this, and I'll throw them back in, and they'll survive. Still, the insides, deep side is still not completely dry, and they're still alive, and they'll do okay. But this one was pretty dry, so I didn't throw him back in. But he can't survive outside the tank, right? No. You think we do okay? Yeah, he might do okay, but he has to be in the water, right? That's how God made him. And so, in the same way, if we are not in communion with God, coming to church and faith and things, then we start to shrivel up our spiritual life and we die. And so when God says, come to church, I'll encourage you and read my Jew and give you. Otherwise, this is how we end up looking. If we turn away from God, if we live as he has created us to live in communion with him. And so that's an illustration of how it is. And so we do continue to encourage each other and yourselves as children, and that we grow and live and beautiful, the fish in the fish tank. They're beautiful And so we are beautiful when we're with Christ. But if we don't, this is sadly what happens. So I'm going to flush this guy down the toilet after the service. That's what you do with fish that die. Yeah. But this, I wanted to keep it as an illustration. Quite something, hey? Have you seen a fish like this? No. So hopefully we won't lose any more. I'm not going to fill the tank up all the way anymore so he can't jump out the others. You can come in them whenever you want. Okay? Okay. We're going to sing now. We're going to sing a song, and then you can go to Sunday school. Okay. Lord bless. We come before God in prayer this morning, and we have opportunity to give thanks for answered prayer. Audrey Langendoon's mom returned home on Friday. She had colon cancer surgery, but that went really well, and so she's home again, and so we praise God for his answer to prayer. And then we prayed for Ted and Mary's brother-in-law, Dan Hill. And so he had brain cancer. And so they did the surgery, and it went very well. And he is also responding well. And so we are very hopeful and thankful that God will provide too healing in his life. then we are going to pray for Joke Vandenbrink. She's doing well, but it is, of course, taking some time till that leg heals in Wolcott. And with the COVID lockdown, it is pretty lonely. But nice people are phoning her, and that's very encouraging, and she really appreciates that. And then Albert and Pauline Benek are celebrating their 45th wedding anniversary this weekend. Praise the Lord. Wonderful. The kids had a real nice celebration for a group of family and friends yesterday, and we give thanks for the many years and that God continues to provide for you. Then we are thankful for the rain, again, just needed and so very nice. We are also just thankful to Rosina Veld, responding well to the treatments that she had, the radiation treatments, and that continues to go well. And then we do want to pray for Marty and Karen Vanderveen and the family. There are just some things in relation to the boys. There's some legal things going on, and just too a little bit of uncertainty there. And we do want to pray, especially too, just for you as a family at this time. Are there other things that you would want included in our prayer this morning? Things of thanks or things of concern? Okay, because yeah, your brother in the walking, that just was that. He's, yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's pray too, because they're trying something again. And yeah, okay, let's pray. Yeah, yeah. No, let's pray for him. Yes, Dave. Okay, Dave mentions too, a colleague from work, Paul Webb, who had a serious fall and really almost died. And he is still, yeah, he's stable, but yeah, it's definitely worrying. So we're going to pray for Paul. And yeah, we want to see too that God would bring healing there. Yes, Kellyanne. Or your Uncle Jeff? Okay. What's the concern there? Okay. He's not feeling well? Okay. Great. There's something going on. Okay. No, absolutely. The Lord knows, and we'll pray that the Lord would provide, that we would get to know, and that help would be available. Okay, lovely. Let's pray together. Oh, wait, sorry, Corinne. Don't overdo it. Beautiful. Yeah, you guys are traveling out. Yeah, so safe travels too. as you make your way to BC. Okay, and yeah, God's blessing on the bike challenge to raise funds for childhood cancer. Very, very nice. Let's pray together. Almighty God, gracious Heavenly Father, it's such a privilege that we can gather in your presence and also that we can lift our hearts in prayer to you. Lord, we, as a family of faith, encouraging and supporting one another and leaning together on your strength and also seeing your faithfulness in so many ways. We thank you that in times of need, you respond, you come alongside, you help and you provide. And so for Audrey with her mom, that all went so well and that she can be home again, we give you thanks and praise. And for Ted and Mary and the family of Dan Hill, Lord, seeing too that with all of the initial uncertainty, Lord, and that things could progress and things could be treated to a large degree, and Lord, that we are so hopeful and thankful that you will continue to provide the healing that he needs, Lord. We praise your name and we entrust family to your gracious care. Lord, we thank you too with the Albert and Pauline, that they can celebrate a beautiful anniversary, Lord, knowing too that you have been there with them over the years and that they, with the family too, could celebrate yesterday and just share again the stories of how everything went and just see again too your faithfulness, Lord. We thank you and praise you too and pray that you would continue to provide too for them for many more good years to come. Lord, we also pray with thanksgiving for Rosina Veld and for her responding well to the treatments that she had. And we pray, too, that you would continue just to work in a strengthening and healing way in her life and her body and that she would just feel better and better each day in your grace. Lord, we pray, too, for your continued care in our lives where the need arises. And Lord, we know, too, that there are physical needs that we encounter, Lorraine's brother, and that as he receives again a new treatment, Lord, it's been discouraging so far, but that you would make a way, that you would provide an end to the pain, and that he could feel able again just to function normally, and that you would provide the health that he needs. Lord, we think too of Dave's friend Paul, who had that nasty fall. We thank you that he's stable. We pray that you would provide also, just in his life too, the sense of your presence and your healing grace, and that you would restore him to his family again in due time. Lord, we think too of Kellyanne's Uncle Jeff, and where there's definitely something not right, and Lord, that we don't know, but you know, and we pray that you would help medical people to find out, and that you would be able to also work in it, that he isn't too worried, and that we can lean on your strength, knowing you know and that you will provide. Lord, we thank you too with Corrine that the biking went so well. People were safe and that the work of supporting research and cancer for children, Lord, what a blessing that can go forward and so many are helped and healed, Lord. And we praise you just for efforts like this that do so much good, bring justice and help in this world. Lord, we thank and praise you too for providing in this way. Lord, we also want to think too of situations too where there's legal concerns and for Marty and Karen and the family, Lord. And just as they are confronted by some of those things, Lord, that you would especially provide the proper help that they need as well as just working through things and recognizing too when things are wrong and moving again in terms of doing what is right and good. Lord, we pray that you would just work in them as a family too with the assurance that you are present, that you are there, and that you would guide and lead in your grace. Lord, we thank you for the rain that we had, and we know too, Lord, you are the one who provides. And in that, we thank you too that we can trust in you. We pray for Joke Vandenbrink and the hospital as she's recovering, and we ask that you would also provide too, just for her the patience she needs so that she will be able to manage through the healing time and can return home to Art and Jackie real soon. Lord, we also know in the summertime a lot of people traveling and that you would grant Corrine and the family safe travels and Lord, that they too can just experience a relaxing time. We think too of others who are traveling at this time. We know, Lord, too, just in the summertime, opportunities after all of the lockdowns, and that people are out and enjoying, and that you would grant to your blessing in that, and in that too, refreshment and assurance again too, that things are going back to normal and that you are providing. Lord, we think too that as we continue to reflect on your word this morning and worship, we thank you that you speak to us through it again in the book of Leviticus, the wonder of holiness, what it is and how we enter in by your grace. Lord, make us true holy people as you are God, are holy. In Jesus, in whose name we pray, amen. We are reading this morning from Leviticus chapter 16 as our Bible reading, our focus for the message. And Leviticus 19 is central chapter in Leviticus, and Leviticus 16 is even more central, talking about the Day of Atonement, the Day of Atonement. And so we're reading first 22 verses of Leviticus 16, and then 29 and 30. And so this is that specific day of forgiveness. The Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron who died when they approached the Lord. So that's an earlier story in Leviticus where the holiness of God is highlighted, and Aaron, two of his sons, die when they approach the Lord in an unholy manner. Verse 2, the Lord said to Moses, tell your brother Aaron that he has not come, is not to come whenever he chooses into the most holy place behind the curtain in front of the atonement cover on the ark, or else he will die, for I will appear in the cloud over the atonement cover. So there's the fear of God, the holiness of God, is awesome, amazing. This is how Aaron is to enter the most holy place. He must first bring a young bull for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. He is to put on the sacred linen tunic with linen undergarments next to his body. He is to tie the linen sash around him and put on the linen turban. These are sacred garments, so he must bathe himself with water before he puts them on. From the Israelite community, he is to take two male goats for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. Aaron is to offer the bull for his own sin offering to make atonement for himself and his household. And he is to take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the entrance to the tent of meeting. He is to cast lots for the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other for the scapegoat. Aaron shall bring the goat whose lot falls to the Lord and sacrifice it for a sin offering, but the goat chosen by lot as the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to be used for making atonement by sending it into the wilderness as a scapegoat. Aaron shall bring the bull for his own sin offering to make atonement for himself and his household, and he is to slaughter the bull for his own sin offering. He is to take the censer full of burning coals from the altar before the Lord and two handfuls of finely ground fragrant incense and take them behind the curtain. He is to put the incense on the fire before the Lord, and the smoke of the incense will conceal the atonement cover above the tablets of the covenant law so that he will not die. He is to take some of the bull's blood and with his finger sprinkle it on the front of the atonement cover, and then he shall sprinkle some of it with his finger seven times before the atonement cover. He shall then slaughter the goat for the sin offering for the people and take its blood behind the curtain and do with it as he did with the bull's blood. He shall sprinkle it on the atonement cover and in front of it, and in this way he will make atonement for the most holy place because of the uncleanness and rebellion of the Israelites, whatever their sins have been. He is to do the same for the tent of meeting, which is among them in the midst of their uncleanness. No one is to be in the tent of meeting from the time Aaron goes in to make atonement in the most holy place until he comes out, having made atonement for himself, his household, and the whole community of Israel. So everyone is forgiven. Then he shall come out to the altar that is before the Lord and make atonement for it. He shall take some of the bull's blood and some of the goat's blood and put it on the horns of the altar. And he shall sprinkle some of the blood on it with his finger seven times to cleanse it and to consecrate it from the uncleanness of the Israelites. When Aaron has finished making atonement for the most holy place, the tent of meeting, and the altar, he shall bring forward the live goat. He is to lay both his hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the wickedness and rebellion of the Israelites, all their sins, and put them on the goat's head. He shall send the goat away into the wilderness in the care of someone appointed for the task, and the goat will carry on itself all their sins to a remote place, and the man shall release it in the wilderness. And then dropping down to verse 29, this is to be a lasting ordinance for you. On the 10th day of the 7th month, you must not deny yourself and not do any work, whether native-born or a foreigner residing among you, because on this day atonement will be made for you to cleanse you. Then before the Lord you will be clean from all your sins. Dear people of God, we have been looking at some of the books of the Bible, and so I hope you've had a chance to read Genesis and Exodus. Genesis, of course, talks about God's work through the generations, through the creation and the fall into sin, and so that's recognized through all the generations. And then Exodus, the salvation, the redemption of God's people. They are led out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of bondage. And so, too, reading through that again, just to be reminded of the reality. We're created by God. We are fallen in sin, but we are redeemed in His grace. Now we're looking at the book of Leviticus, the book of holiness. Now, it's not often we talk about holiness, just even in our daily discussion of things. Sometimes you'll hear it, people have an expression, if something strikes them, and they'll say, you know, holy cow, what was that? Or they'll say something like that, right? And it's kind of an awe, kind of, but it's not the sense of holiness. We have the sense of, like on the Bible it says, holy Bible, right? And so the sense of holiness has to do with godliness, has to do with reverence for God, has to do with obedience to His Word. And so holiness, we talk about it often as a church, and in the book of Leviticus, 75 times it's mentioned. Holiness, be holy, God is holy, He makes us holy. And so that's what we're looking at this morning. Now, the first thing in terms of, well, what is that like? What does that look like? How does that work exactly? And in the book of Leviticus, cleanliness, clean and unclean, is mentioned often, 30 times. And so it just so happens, after Vacation Bible School here and after COVID, on Monday in this church, John Reinberg, he had it all organized, and a person came to clean the carpets. I don't know if you noticed it as you walked in, but that hallway was not very good. And after Vacation Bible School, there had been just a few accidents along the way. And over COVID too, stuff had happened. So those two guys came in and spent the whole day, and it was from unclean to clean. It was beautiful. And so, from unholy to holy. You could have eaten off of that carpet. It was so clean. And you say, oh, what a difference. What a difference. You wouldn't really want to, and it was looking pretty bad. So we did that on Monday, and then already in terms of the work of the summer students, we'd sent to them that part of your work is going to be to clean the padding of the benches. And so they did that on Tuesday. They were in here on Tuesday, and they had cloths, and they had water, and they had the vacuum, and they were working over all the spots on all the benches. So you are sitting on the cleanest bench you've sat in for quite a while. Everything is clean in here. The carpet, the benches, and they wiped the backs of everything, and they wiped the pulpit, and they, boy. So from unclean to clean. And then on Thursday, they did all the windows. All the windows. And the window hadn't been done for a while. And you think, too, they did the outsides, they did the insides. So we are holy. We are clean. And you say, wow, holy cow, this place, this place is really cleaned up. And so there's a level of holiness in terms of cleanliness, in terms of the dirt of sin, the dirt of life. Dirt gets in everywhere. Dirt makes everything just not good, not right, not nice. And the stains of sin make us unholy. And so holiness is to be cleansed. To be clean. And so we sang too, the blood of Christ cleanses us from all our sin. And so that is definitely one side of being cleansed, being restored, people being enabled to be in relationship with God again. It feels better to be clean, to be bright. It's inviting, it's safe. The holiness of God. No darkness, no danger, no evil, no sin. You want to remove those things. So that's when you think of holiness, and I thought it fit really nice. I hadn't planned it that way, that Leviticus would be this Sunday, but it worked really good. Everything is clean. So notice that as you go out, be reminded. That the goodness of God cleanses us. Another sense of holiness is tied to wholeness. And the reality that in sin we are broken. And the holiness of God restores us. We are broken in body, mind, in relationships. But we are made whole again, holy in God's grace. And so, even in the prayer, talking about, too, the struggles of illness, of weakness, of just in terms of our body, sin, we were created perfect. But in sin, all those struggles are there. And so, that's a reality of the brokenness. Then in terms of our minds, too, and so our thinking gets messed up and is broken so often in sin, and we do things that are wrong. And later we would even ask ourselves, what was I thinking? And so, I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have gone there. I should have done this or that or whatever in terms of godly things. And so that brokenness is there. And then in terms of relationships too, and we know it in our society, relationships break down, and marriages break down, and there's things in friendships and in families, and things break down. There's brokenness. You say, why is that? Well, that's sin again. That causes that division. And finally, there's our relationship with God. And that too gets broken. And we lose interest in God, and we're not faithful as we should be in church. And we are always wondering too, doing devotions and living close to the Lord, and that sin breaks that down. Say, don't bother with that, don't take time for that, that's a waste of time. And we give into that and the brokenness, and then our faith dries up like that little fish, and we're dead in our sin. And so we recognize that as the work of unholiness that breaks down our faith. So the initial effort to restore that is here, the book of Leviticus. And the book of Leviticus is based on the work of the tribe of Levi. And so if you read through Genesis, Exodus, you know there's 12 tribes. And one tribe of Levi, and the tribe of Levi takes a central role. Moses was from the tribe of Levi, and so was Aaron. And on Mount Sinai, when God gave Moses the law, in Genesis 22, we talked about it when we looked at Genesis, the golden calf, the people turned away right away into sin. They broke that relationship already. And then it says in Genesis 22, the Levites, as a people, as a tribe, they defended God's holiness. He says, not right. What you're doing is wrong. You're worshiping an idol. You are stepping away from all that God has done for you. And so in that, then they come forward as the ones who are zealous for God's holiness. And though they'd made a complete mess of things, God's people, God, through Moses, intervened, and the Levites defended God's holiness, and then they continue in the service of God. And then the ministry of defending God's holiness and restoring people to God takes the form of the sacrificial system, where a lamb or a goat or a ram or a bull is offered to take away the sins of the people and to restore holiness and obedience to God. And that's what's in the book of Leviticus. So your assignment this week is to read through it. As you read through it, you will notice that over and over again in terms of defending the holiness of God, and then the different sacrifices are presented in terms of this is how you are restored in this way. And so that whole sense of restoration, beautifully expressed and visibly for the people to see. They could bring a lamb, they would put their hand on the lamb, their sin transferred to the lamb was taken and offered on their behalf so that God would not hate them and kill them. God would receive them and restore them in his grace. So it was a constant, beautiful ministry that way. It is, as we read through it, a good reminder for us today. When you read through Leviticus 2, we are called to be holy. So even out of Leviticus 19, I read this command too. Just a sense of honesty and integrity. So how do we live as Christians? What does the book of Leviticus say to us? Well, don't be dishonest. And the example here was they had, of course, scales for buying and selling and different weights and measures, and those could be manipulated, and sinful people would do that, and there was really no governing body or standard to check. And so it was up to you, your integrity, your honesty. Are you going to take advantage of people unknowingly just for your own greed? Are you going to be honest and integrity, being a faithful witness to God and just serving for him, first of all, an honest witness in terms of your life and then in terms of your faith? If you're not honest in your life, how can you share your faith with someone? If you're cheating them, if you're stealing from them, and you go to them and say, oh, you should be a Christian, I'm a Christian, doesn't work. That does not work. You have to have that honesty, that integrity. And I thought it was nice at the garage sale here when we had it here, and everything here, like we went through it, a bunch of people too. We had, Kathy helped, others helped too. And there were some people had, accidentally added pretty junky stuff. There was some junky stuff, a little bit of junky stuff. So we just got rid of that. Junk is junk. We're not selling junk. We're selling good stuff to people. People came in, they looked at it, they said, oh, this is good stuff. And everything here worked, and so too. And through that too, like almost all of it sold, because it wasn't junk. People came in, it was good stuff. We need it, we could use it, we blessed them with it, and we give them an honest price for it. And too, you could say to them, does this work? Yes, it works. Is it good? Yes, it's good. And that sense of integrity, that we can then deal well with people and they respond well. Say, hey, appreciate that. And so living out our faith, just one example of how we do that. The outline of the book of Leviticus, it works through five different things. First of all, how to make things holy. So the first seven chapters, all the sacrifices. And so that's a powerful section too. And then it talks about those who serve, and so priests and Levites, and it explains, and what we read a bit of that in chapter 16, how Aaron had to dress, but there's a sense of the holiness of God there, and so we want to preserve that. And then it talks about clean and unclean, the third section, and though that example, and we need to be clean and do what's clean before God. And then the most holy day, we're going to talk about that in a minute, and then holy living. How we live it out. All of life, try to live out all your life in terms of keeping God at the center and living as a Christian witness to Him. And that's the direction of holiness as we seek to serve God. Leviticus 16 is an amazing chapter. Here are the two goats. What's it talking about? I noticed even as I was reading, you're thinking too, it's a little bit, it goes into quite a bit of detail. But the Day of Atonement is huge. Still, in the Jewish faith and in Hebrew, you know it as Yom Kippur. You'll see it on calendars. It is official high holy day. And in the Hebrew sense of it, here in Leviticus 16, it's a day on which a sacrifice is made, and the sacrifice is actually one sacrifice, though it talked there too about Aaron just getting himself ready to make the sacrifice, and in that too, he is purifying himself, and in that we see Jesus who comes as the sacrifice, but Jesus, holy, completely holy Son of God. So to come and make the sacrifice, even as you read there in Leviticus 16, that Aaron has to be holy. He has to have, too, his sin covered. As Jesus comes, he is the holy Son of God. So we see that. And then these two goats, actually a single sin offering, but showing the work of God in two ways, very much a visible sign. So the one becomes the scapegoat. And so you hear about that, and we do get that in our language once in a while too. You're a scapegoat, or someone's made a scapegoat. Here, very specifically, in terms of sin being taken away, hands being placed on the one goat, the goat being sent out into the wilderness, and there's a sense of people watching and people looking. And then if you think about Psalm 103, where God says, I will remove your sins as far as the east is from the west. There they go. They're not holding you back. So often in our life too, people are living thinking about stuff that happened in their past too, and it slows them down. It stops them. I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. But God takes our sins away, renews us in grace every day. And so for them to see the goat going away, our sins are taken away. That was a beautiful sign for them. And then that the other goat is actually sacrificed on the altar. That the life of the goat takes the place of their life. And so that substitutionary atonement. So on that day, sin is paid for and sin is taken away. And so as the people saw that, did that, that was, they were convinced, my sin is forgiven. All of those things listed there, though I haven't done them perfectly at all, I am right with God. He will hear my prayer. He will watch over me in His grace. And so that assurance is there. And that one day, one sacrifice makes everything holy. So as we read that, as we read through that, then we think of Jesus, who on one day, Good Friday, died on the cross to take away our sin, and in his death he took it away, and that we are restored when we put our faith in him. That's the message of Leviticus. By faith, all who believe will walk in the holiness of his forgiving love. And so that beautiful symbolism is our hope. And so we seek to live that out. There's different examples here. The one I just want to touch on is Leviticus 23, the generosity of people. Don't harvest to the edges of your fields. And if you know the gleaners ministry in our area too, to be generous and to help in terms of others, all kinds of ways we can live it out. And the sense too, this phrase is repeated a number of times in Leviticus, that we are called to be holy because our God is holy. And so he keeps calling us into that stature, that sense of, okay, we want to show and live out your holiness, God. And in 1 Peter 1, same phrase is mentioned, call to live fully into what God has done. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, dear Lord Jesus, we give you thanks and praise for being that one sacrifice that assures us that our sins are forgiven, that we can come into your presence here in worship, that we can come before you, our holy God, in prayer, that we can know for sure that you are there for us, that you are watching over us, and that though we don't deserve it at all, that you, in your grace, continue to make a way for us. We thank you for that assurance again this morning. We pray that we would live into it and live it out and be your holy people in all we do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to respond in singing our song of thanksgiving. And we're going to sing, "You Are Holy." We'll stand to sing.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
You are brave.
In the assurance of God's grace, we go with his blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with kindness and give you his peace. And all God's people said, do join us for fellowship here. We have coffee and nice just to visit again together.